is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. Very excited to have a longtime friend and colleague on this interview, Katherine Eitel. Hey, Katherine, how are you?
I couldn't be better on a Saturday morning. And just, you know, Gary, it's always an honor to be on your show. And I have to just take a second and just say what a great gift this is to our profession and our industry. It's really, you interview the best people, interesting conversations. So for me, it's just a pleasure and an honor. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Katherine. If you're a new listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, you're in for a real treat. Katherine and I have been friends for many years, and she is absolutely amazing. And I'm just going to flat out tell you, you're one of my favorite people in dentistry, Katherine.
Well, that's high praise coming from you. Thank you.
Well, you bring such a passion and commitment and integrity to everything you do. And it's people like, you know, I've always said, and I know you feel, we've had so many conversations about this, but what makes our profession so great is the people.
Yep.
And I love every time I get a chance to spend time with you. And if Tom happens to be there, it's a bonus, you know. He's a pretty good guy.
I think so too.
Yeah, we got to spend some time together in Santa Fe this past mm-hmm. June. And it was fun spending time with Tom as well. But hey, we are going to, if you're new to the Thriving Dentist Show, welcome. You're in for a real treat. The topic we're going to talk about is one of my favorite topics. We're going to talk about the value of unscripted communication. What do you think, Katherine?
Yeah, you know, there's no doubt that all of us are striving to be better communicators, because you don't have to be really very bright to know that if you learn to communicate really well, things in your life get better. Work gets better. Relationships get better. Your outcomes improve. And so communication, certainly, you know, we raise better children. I mean, all the way around, learning to communicate to another person where your message lands the way you intended it to land, that you created the clarity you wanted around whatever it was you were saying, and also you landed it with enough inspiration that the other person actually is inclined to do it. That's a really important skill, maybe one of the most important. Traditionally, the way that trainers and coaches and therapists and lots of different people that are helping others to learn to communicate better, the mechanism that's been used has been a script. And I think, you know, it's not necessarily a bad idea, because where it grew from was that someone was good at communicating this thing well, whatever the communication is, whether that's a sales communication or a, you know, a management level communication or whatever it is. And the idea was that I found a way to be effective at this. So maybe if I write it down and give it to you and you copy it, you'll have the same results. And sometimes that is the case. And mm-hmm. the problem is that often it's not that simple, because as we'll discuss later, I'm sure in our podcast, that that's not the words are not the driving component of communication. The words are not the driving component.
That's that's an interesting way to start our discussion, Katherine, because I have a slide in many of my courses, and I think you've seen this, but I have a slide and it says something like this. I said, communication is often the number one challenge in many dental practices. And then below it, it says something like this. It says, the patient doesn't often hear, in the case of this example, I'm talking about, say, doctor to patient communication. And I say below that in the slide, it says something like this. The patient doesn't often hear what we think we said.
Yes.
The patient doesn't hear what. And then further, it goes on to say, in many cases, very little communication is actually happening. And yet there's words going back and forth. So to punctuate the comment that you just made, Katherine, I have some pretty hard research on this, and I share it with my dental students at Midwestern, and the dental students hear this so many times from me that they always get it right in our exams. but the statistic is that if you study linguistics and you study the field of communication, only 7% of a message is composed of the words. So in other words, when we're trying to communicate with one another, only 7% of the message is made up of the words, which on first blush, you're looking at this and then, no, wait, you must have this wrong, Gary. Don't you mean 93% of the message is words? No, actually 7%. The other 93% is everything else. So Katherine, what are some of the everything else's? What else? What else makes up a message?
I know that that research was actually done by Albert Mehrabian, who was a UCLA professor, and in his doctoral work, in that whole body of research, he created a book called Silent Messages, and that's where that's where we've heard that. I think he said 8%, but it was right there.
Right.
And
yeah, I better change it. It's 8%. Albert's right.
Right. 8%. But the truth is that 55% of a message is communicated via body language, mm-hmm. and the remaining 34% is tone. So we know this intuitively. If you said to your spouse, "What's wrong, honey?" and your spouse said nothing, and if you were in person, they crossed their arms and frowned and kind of cocked their head and said nothing. If the words we say and the tone and the body language line up, if they're congruent, we're golden.
Right.
If they're incongruent, the body language and tone will trump the words every time. And the reason for that is that communication is not necessarily an auditory game. It's an energy game.
It's multifactorial.
Yes, yes. And so when we teach communication, it's one of those coaching moments where it's simultaneously freeing the way we teach it and scary. Because what we believe is that everybody is wired exactly the way they're supposed to be wired. There are no mistakes there. If you're funny, if you're naturally funny, you should be funny. You should be more of that. You should be, if you're naturally kind and sweet and gracious, a lot of people in the South, that's just how they're wired, you know, that they should be more of that. What we want to say is, are you really embracing who you are and showing up the biggest you can possibly show up as in your conversations with patients, with coworkers, with family members around your dinner table? Are you really bringing that to bear? And in doing that, are you now looking for ways that you can frame your emotional platform so that when you speak from that platform, the words flow, the words come, they're authentic to you, but they're right on target, they're right on message. And so a lot of what we do is say, yes, we're going to spend some time on what you say, but before we ever go, that'll be a lot easier to do, and it'll come a lot more naturally than you suspect for you to be brilliant in word choice when you get the space between your ears and the space within your gut and heart correct, and you stand on a very strong emotional platform of confidence and kindness and openness. And, you know, some of those platforms, if we can get you there first, energetically, then when you go to choose your words, it will come across in this congruent way with words, tone, and body.
Oh, I love that.
Yeah, that's really where communication does not start with words. The communication starts with beliefs and the platform from which you're speaking emotionally and psychologically. The words come from there. So that's why when you're handed a script, if you aren't already the person that wrote that script is believable when they say it, because mm-hmm. they're standing on strong beliefs that those words support. If you don't aren't standing in that place and you try to adopt those words, there's incongruency and the listener has a radar for it. They have a radar for, is there incongruency between body language tone, the delivery of it, and the words you actually
chose? Can I add a qualifier to that?
Yeah.
A highly accurate radar.
Yes.
You know, Katherine, I want to credential you for our listeners in case they are hearing you for the first time and they don't know of you. And I could actually spend the entire podcast episode providing your accolades and credentials, but I know you wouldn't like that. But I just want to say this. Katherine's been a friend for many, many years, and I consider her the absolute master at teaching communication skills. She's the master communication skills coach. How's that for a credential, Katherine?
That's about the best you could pick.
Would you take a minute, though, and give our listeners a little bit of a Reader's Digest summary of your background so they can know a little bit about your perspective?
Sure. Well, my company is a communications coaching company that developed, primarily in healthcare and dentistry, though in the last year or two, we've really branched out into other industries as well, some corporate work, and really, really excited about that. Because for us, being a communications coaching company, it's those techniques are the same no matter what industry we're in. But my heart has been for many decades in dentistry because that's where I started my professional working career as a chairside dental assistant for years, and then eventually worked my way up to the administration area of the practice and managed a multi-location practice for a number of years. And then through a series of events, found myself in coaching and consulting. And so for the last few decades, that's what my company has done, similar to what you do so well, Gary, providing consulting and coaching mm-hmm. support for dental practices. And in doing that, like for many of us, I found that the piece of that I was best at, that was most natural for me and that I enjoyed the most, was all the pieces in consulting that turned on or rested on communication skills. And so over time, we've just decided that that's our sweet spot and that's what we're going to become the best and the experts in. And so that's brought me to this day. But I definitely, you know, as we expand into other industries, I realized that there was great luxury and comfort in knowing an industry so well that you're helping them to communicate within. And I know dentistry. I know it from the clinical back office perspective. I know it from the administrative perspective and from a leadership perspective. You know, I've owned a small business, so I get it from those angles. And sometimes that's the missing piece when I go into an industry. I've done some work in the fashion industry. It's like I don't really come from there. So I'm really having to get a quick, deep education in what their world looks like. But I really do know dentistry. So your audience today is one that I have great admiration for.
We're in your sweet spot.
Yeah, you're in my
seat. I want to compliment you. We're going to talk a little bit later about some of the workshops and training that you do. But a mutual friend of ours, a dear mutual friend of ours, Stacy Savalas, just returned from some training that she did with you. And Stacy's amazing. And she came back so charged up and so excited about all the new things that she had learned in your workshops. She was there for a couple of workshops for you. And she came back so charged up. We're going to talk a little bit more about those. But Katherine, you do amazing work and you are affecting so many people in such a positive way by teaching them how to communicate and how to be genuine and how to be authentic and how to be congruent. You use that term congruence. And I want to repeat that because I think that's so important. When the words and the message and the presentation and the body language are all congruent, the likelihood that your message is going to land on point is very high.
That's right.
And you do that so well. Let's dive in if we could, Katherine. Mm-hmm. We all know that effective communication is the core of great relationships, better work performance, and leadership at every level. I know you're a champion of that idea, and your company, Lionspeak, we're going to talk about that a little bit, is dedicated to newly branding your company under the name Lionspeak. Very excited about that. You're dedicated to helping people learn how to communicate well, but not in a traditional sense. because you teach something called unscripted communication skills. And I'm going to share a bias, and I feel like I need to put that bias out right here. I have a bias against scripting. There, I said it. And can I share with you, Katherine, why I have that bias against that? It's really from a personal experience that goes back over 30 years. In fact, 31 years ago, I was teaching workshops with Dr. Omer Reed. Now, Katherine, you know Dr. Reed.
Oh, well, I don't know him personally, but I wish I did. And I envy you for having that known him.
Omer's been a mentor of mine since 1980. We've had him on the show and just an amazing, amazing resource and a great friend for many years. And in the mid 80s, I used to teach courses with Dr. Reed. Mm-hmm. And one of the courses we taught was on case presentation. In other words, how to talk to patients about dentistry to get them excited about dentistry. And elective care and you know, some things that we could do that were beyond the, you know, traditional drill, fill, and bill kind of dentistry. You know, and you have to go back to 1984 and 1985 to understand that, you know, in many ways, the profession was really blossoming, you know, at that time. And Omer, in many ways, is just a master communicator. And I would watch doctors take the course. It was a three-day course. This is a three-day communication course, Katherine. We started at 7 in the morning and finished at 7 at night. 3 days in a row, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. They had 36 hours of content, if you can imagine that. And in some ways, we felt like we barely nicked the surface of what could be covered, you know. And I'd watch doctors, and because Omer was so good at it, they would try to be Omer. Mm-hmm. And Omer is charismatic. He's dynamic. He's highly personable, high energy. So you know that you can imagine that type, right? And if you're listening to that, you can imagine an individual that is dynamic, highly energetic, very personable, and imagine a doctor trying to mimic that because they said, well, what Omer does it so well, I'm going to do it like that. And they would literally write down the words that Omer would say. Mm-hmm. And script them, because Omer didn't teach scripting, but they would take it and script it out. And then they'd call me back a month later and say how much trouble they were having with that because it wasn't working. They didn't understand, well, it worked for Dr. Reed. It's not working for me. Mm-hmm. And I would have to kind of redirect them and say, well, let's go back to some of the things that you learned. Let's go back to some of the skill set that you learned and some of the concepts that you learned, and let's make them yours.
Yeah.
So it was a little sidebar, but that's where my bias against scripting arose, because I saw it done in a way that was not effective because it wasn't congruent. And then the other bias that I have is a personal bias, Katherine, and I'll just share this personally, and maybe it's your experience as well. I have a pretty good radar screen myself when I'm in communication with people, and I can pick up pretty quickly when someone is reading off a script. or communicating off a script to me. And it instantly pushes me away because I feel like it's not genuine. Mm-hmm. And so my bias is against scripting. And yet I know that there's a lot of, there's a lot of concepts in dentistry today on communication that revolve around these scripts. You know, there's the book of scripts and there's scripting concepts. And I'm just going to share my bias against that. I happen to think, and I'd ask your opinion on this, Katherine, I happen to think that the best communication is that which is genuine. And I believe that if we can be genuine with it, our communication is going to be more effective. So there's my bias against scripting. And I know that you teach something called unscripted communication skills. But let me challenge that. Don't most people learn to say things differently in order to improve their communication skills? In other words, don't most people need to see, practice, and adopt a new script if they want to get better and more effective?
Well, here's the thing that here's where I think scripts came into being, and the intention was right. And that was owners of practices or managers, administrators of practices who have now have a group of people working for them down line, they have a vision of how they want to be perceived by the public, how they want consumers to be treated and to interpret the level of service that's being given from the business. And so what they're after is that is a level of consistency all the way from the top, all the way through to the front lines.
And they think that a scripted scripting is a path to get that.
Right. And so I actually really agree that one of the strongest business objectives especially small business should have is finding a way to create consistency. So no matter who answers the phone, the caller is going to receive the same level of service, of welcome, of information exchange. All of that is going to be consistent with the company brand, with the company line, with everything that they're about. And if they, no matter who interviews the new patient, or no matter who is being brought in for an employee review conversation, at any level, we want consistency. We don't want people to be treated differently just because there's another person doing the communication. So I get that why a lot of business owners appreciate scripts and want scripting is because they, I believe slightly erroneously, believe that the only way they can achieve consistency of service is to provide scripting. And I would just like to suggest that I think there's another way to do both. I think there's a way to get consistency from the top all the way to the front lines and also have it be more effective. And the way we do that is, well, a couple of ways. One is to recognize, I think that you can't have success with this line of thinking unless you believe that there's greatness in all the people who work for you. That whether they bring it or you've seen it yet or not, the way this works is you really, as the manager or the leader or the person that's the trainer, believes that each of these people is wired how they're supposed to be. There's nothing to change there. But our job is to motivate them to tap into that greatness, for them to believe they have it, and for them to bring it. And my challenge when I coach people, I push them fairly hard because I want them to tap into their own greatness, not to try to mimic me, because that's the teach the man to fish theory, right? Mm-hmm. If I can get them to see that and believe that in themselves and constantly be challenging that within themselves, they always have it. They always have it with them. The ruby slippers are always on. That's the first piece.
Part of what I'm hearing on this, Katherine, and check me on this, but your method to me seems to be much more comprehensive, because let's just talk about dentistry and the challenges, say, that our administrative team members get. There's no way to script every possibility that you might be presented with a patient.
No.
But if you teach them the concepts of how to communicate representing the values of the practice, yes, then they're literally prepared for whatever situation, whatever curve or knuckleball might be thrown their way.
That's right.
They're prepared for it. But you're helping me understand, though, why some might think that scripting has value because of the idea of creating consistency within the organization. You've given me a different perspective on it, so thank you for that. What I heard you say loud and clear, though, is there's a way to have consistency.
Yes.
And not fall into raw scripts.
Well, there's a way to have both consistency and authentic effectiveness. So where we get things congruent, where things line up, and the patient or the coworker or the family member, you know, the teenager at your dinner table, they believe you. They believe you, and that your message is consistent with, you know, what you wanted it to be, or what someone, you know, the owner of the business wants it to be.
Are you suggesting that communication skills might be useful at home too?
Oh, you know, every now and then, every now and then, you know, Tom and I, we use these. We find ourselves, nobody is perfect at this. And the best I think we can hope to be is have such a heightened awareness and such a good set of skills in our holsters that we recognize when we're off. We recognize when we've been triggered. We recognize when we're not communicating or the results are not what we were wanting, and we're not sounding like the people we want to be. And we know how to pull back and engage those tools. And so, you know, I gave you one tool is that belief that not only do we have greatness inside of us, that we don't always tap into and we don't always access, but so do others. And that's the first thing. The second thing is that while I don't appreciate or teach or believe in scripting per se, I do believe in protocols. Those are different. Protocols. So protocols are like what you teach. They're a system. So in communications, we don't have, you know, we don't have buttons to push on a, you know, on a laptop, on a software system, but that doesn't mean there aren't systems. And I think what helps is, at least in, well, I wouldn't even say just in business, in any communication, if you have this solid platform of belief that people have greatness and it's up to us to see it and access it, and then you have a protocol that you know how to handle conflict, like a little system that when you realize conflict is marching down the hallway, wagging a finger at you, saying, I want to talk to you, right? And you recognize that as oncoming conflict. You have a system, you have a protocol that you can count on, that that piece won't change. That piece you've memorized, you won't, that won't change. But it's not a protocol of words. It's a protocol of method.
It's almost like this is a little awkward because it's not exactly this, but it's almost like a checklist.
Yes.
For example, if your ears are burning on Monday afternoons, I teach my D2 dental student class, your method of conflict resolution using your six steps. And we teach your six steps. And it's, I teach them like a checklist, that it isn't the word, we're not scripting it,
no.
But what we're doing is we're saying that what we say need to fit into the guidelines and protocols in this checklist. For example, one of those, and we'll get into this, we'll talk about conflict because I think that's such a, that's a minefield in the area of communication. We'll talk about that a little bit. But one of those is to not look back, but in fact, to look forward to solutions. That's one of the six steps. Right. But I love that. I love the way you've taught that because it is the difference between scripts and protocols. And it allows you to be consistent with your messaging.
Yes.
And yet have the words that are natural and organic and congruent.
Yes. Yes. And that's really where, you know, when you get with a team, when you sit down with your team and you create protocols for all the major communication intersections in your practice, you have actually given them a container or a place where they can kind of, some touchstones where they can feel safe within that protocol. It's very reassuring when people get the protocol down and they've got it. It's just part of who they don't, you know, I always say, I teach phone skills a lot. And I say to them, you know, level one is you're given a script and you repeat the script and you memorize the script. Level two of in terms of your expertise is you've created a flow chart or a protocol where you've got some supporting documents that help you stay within that protocol, but you're able to be who you are. Level three, in terms of expertise, is you don't need any paper. I could pick up that phone in the lab with no VIP intake form for a new patient call, but I know the four steps to a great call every time, and I can do it in my sleep. And it doesn't matter what questions the patient asks me. It doesn't matter where they take the phone call. I know how to stay within those four steps, within those four touchstones, and I can manage that call. I can lead that call, get it back on track, and I don't need a script to do that. I need to know those protocols. So same with conflict, the same with a leadership conversation. I coach a lot of business owners to stand up before a team. Sometimes there's four people, sometimes there's 400 people. But that leader, at least once a year, in my opinion, needs to take the stage, metaphorically speaking, in front of that group and rally the troops, reminding them where we're headed.
What are we about?
What are we about? What are our values? What do we stand for? What does it mean to be a part of us? And where are we going? And why are we excited about it? And what do we know and not know? That conversation, we used to script that. When early in my career, when I didn't know any better, we would script that. And now one of my most fun things to do is to take an owner who's not maybe a public speaker, but is a great business leader, and help them figure out how to authentically stand with no script and recalibrate their team to their vision this year, and do it in a way that people are just sitting at on the edge of their seats and can't wait to get going. And they believe in it and they subscribe to it. How does a leader do that? And they don't do it by sounding like Katherine Eitel. They do it by sounding like the best version of them, because they're the ones who created this vision. And part of that work is creating a vision that actually did come from them. They didn't take a vision of somebody else and say, that sounds good, I think I'll put my name on it. It's really just talk to me, you know, just talk. If we were going to sit down over a cup of coffee, and you were going to tell me in your wildest dreams, where would you be in 5 years? What would your business, what kind of work would you be doing? Where would you be doing it? Who would you be doing it with? What kind of hours would you be working? What kind of money would you be making? If I can get them to just talk to me, then I help them frame that in a way that they can stand up and deliver that to their team. And I just had an experience, Gary, recently with an owner. It was a perfect example of this. He had come to one of my lectures and he called me and said, Katherine, I need this immediately. I have been a solo practitioner for my entire career. He was probably close to 50. Mm-hmm. And he said he's in a suburb of Detroit. So very hard hit area in terms of, you know, income levels and also insurance, the impact of insurance and a lot of, you know, corporations that have left the area.
A lot of headwinds.
And he said, we live in this community, this suburb community that I grew up in. My parents grew up in. My children have grown up in. And now some have come back to, you know, have families here. He said, I love this community. I'm involved in a church here. I'm involved in civic organizations. I've had my practice here. And I truly love this community and the families that live here. And what I've seen is the decline of private practice and the influx of corporate dentistry. And for us, it hasn't been in a good way. It hasn't had a good – I feel like our patients and our community at large has – a not really good choices. They have these high, you know, practices that the only way they know how to deliver dentistry is at a very high fee that a lot of these people cannot afford. Or there is this lower fee, but lower quality access to care, nothing in the middle. And he said to me, this was literally over a cup of coffee, I don't know how to do it. I'm not exactly sure if I can. But if I were dreaming, I would say I would like to form a small group of their practices where people are, you know, dentists are retiring or they're leaving the area. I would like to buy some of those practices and see if I could create a small group environment that could fulfill middle of the road, where we could be so efficient and have economies of scale, at least to the degree that we could bring our fee structure down somewhat, so that it becomes more affordable for the most of the people in this socioeconomic area. And we do it in a way that does not decrease our quality.
So I'm hearing him say in a short segment, deliver quality care affordably.
Yeah. Where he felt that being a solo practitioner, he wasn't mm-hmm. able to do it. And he was having to deny a lot of people access because of the fee. And so I said, well, I'll tell you what, you got a lot of smart people working for you. And my guess is there's some smart people working for the practices you're going to be acquiring. And I think just what you told me is exactly the way we need to stand up and talk about this. And so he did. I coached him. Mm. He brought me out to help facilitate, because I can't deliver the vision for a business. It's not my business.
Right.
So I can facilitate the whole day, but that's the piece that they have to do. The owner has to do that. And so he did. I prefaced it. I got everybody kind of connected and we did all that. But once that happened, we got him up and he spoke from the heart. And he basically said, look, here's my dream. Here's why. Here's my why. Mm-hmm. And I don't have it all figured out. I have some things figured out, but I don't have it all figured out. And what I'm putting before all of you is, if this is of interest to you, if this gets you as excited as it gets me, I want to spend the rest of the day and probably many days to come creating a team where we'd figure it out together, where we create our own C-suite level of employees. So there's opportunity for some of you to step up to some places and learn some things you haven't. I want to surround myself with people who can help us figure this out. And if that doesn't excite you, I get it. And you'll be fine and I'll be fine and we'll figure it out together and we'll get you where you need to be. But if you want to be on this bus going forward, here's where I'm going and here's what I need. And I'm going to give you some time to think about it. But that's decision. You know, the train's leaving the station, basically. And he got a little emotional. He said, you know, I'm doing this for sheer love of this community. And I feel like they deserve this.
Well, and I'm sure you sensed that in your coffee shop conversation with him. I'm sure you sensed that when he said, hey, my parents were born here. I was born here. I raised my kids here. I love this community. Yeah. And I don't like to see what's going on in terms of the what he saw as limited options in dental care in his community. And he was trying to preserve something. He was passionate about trying to preserve something.
And it was so interesting, Gary, because I went in, we called a break afterwards, and I went into the women's restroom, and I overheard, two of the practices he had just recently purchased. And he said to them, I'm not looking to grow to 100 practices. Right now, this could change, but right now, I see this as being maybe 6 practices, maybe at the outside 8. But right now, this would be what would be considered a relatively small group. That's where we are. But he had just purchased in the last few months 2 of them. So when we brought everybody together, for some of these people, it was the very first time they had met the other staffs that, you know, team members that worked in the other locations. And this was the first time they were meeting. And so I go into the women's restroom, and here are all these people that are, some of them are very new to each other. And it was all this conversation about, oh my gosh, this was so different than what I was expecting this morning. I've been looking for another job because I thought we were becoming corporate I hate to say corporate because I don't think this is across the board, this is the case. But what she said was, I thought we were becoming something that would represent low quality, low fee, low service. And I don't want to be any part of that. And I was looking for another job. And now I see this quite differently, and I'm really excited to hear what this is going to be about. And so by speaking authentically, by speaking scripted, I gave him some protocols. I said, you got to hit this piece, this piece, this piece. But do it from your voice. Do it from your heart. Do it from your unique position and let them see that. Don't worry about being perfect, because people will forgive the wrong word if they feel that the energy behind it and the feeling and the philosophy behind it is congruent. They'll forgive that, but they won't when it's not. So that was a great example of someone standing up being so powerful in an unscripted yet organized, methodical way of rallying his troops to a brand new vision. And it was spectacular. And I couldn't have done it for him.
That's a great example of the power of communication when it's genuine and congruent. Yeah, we touched on this a little bit, but I want to spend a little bit more time on this conflict and conflict resolution and conflict communication. So what about handling conflict or difficult conversations? And let me use a specific example, because I'm sure many of our listeners will appreciate that. What about a conversation with, say, an underperforming team member? And I know that many of our listeners may have been provided scripts for that, you know, that may have come from HR departments or whatever, but we're talking about unscripted communication. So can you help our listeners understand a little bit more about conflict resolution, difficult conversations, and doing it in an unscripted manner?
Well, you know, I think we do see conflict and challenging, what we term as challenging conversations. The underlying feeling is that they're going to be difficult and they're going to be hard, and people are going to get their feelings hurt, and it's not going to end well. you know? And so I think we avoid it. I think we often, I know I have in the past, I avoid saying what I really want to say or need to say, because I don't see a good outcome. And I'm worried that the person that I need to have this conversation with is someone I care about. And I don't want them to feel bad, but I do need them to hear this. And so we avoid it. And I'd like to offer a different paradigm for your listeners. I think if we could learn a protocol that we felt sure in and felt safe within, that every time we're in conflict or we're looking to have a heart-to-heart conversation with anyone, that we come from a platform that, number one, we're learning. We're not here to convince someone that we're right. We're actually here to promote that all of us are at what we call at choice. We're always at all times operating from choice. So this isn't about, if you go into a conversation, if I'm going to sit down with an underperforming employee that I really care about as a person, and I sit down and the emotional platform I'm going to utter my words from is one of, I believe you're just fine whether you work here or you don't work here. You're smart, you're capable, you're a good person. And if you don't end up long-term working here, you're going to find a place you eventually that you fit perfectly, and you're going to be fine. And I'm going to be fine whether you step up to what we need you to do here or whether you don't and we find someone else. You know, either way, we're both going to be fine. And what I want to do is make sure that you feel as powerful as you are, that you feel as powerful as I feel in terms of our choices. And so I'm not trying to change you. I'm not trying to force you. Nobody could force somebody anyway. What I want you to do is understand what's expected if you choose to work here, that there are expectations that aren't being met that will need to be met, and that I'm your partner. I'm your partner in, if you want to work here, I'm your partner in figuring out how we can get you to that level so that you can be successful. And if not, I respect it. I respect that you always are at choice. You should be. And this may not, for whatever reason, be a good fit for you right now. And if it isn't, it's okay. And you're not wrong. You're not bad. I think if we took the whole idea of things are wrong, right or wrong, or good or bad, and we just said it works or it doesn't work. You know, it's in alignment or mm-hmm. it's not in alignment. And doesn't mean you're good or bad or right or wrong. And so if we take some of that stuff out, conflict doesn't seem like it's going to be this awkward, you know,
kind of you against them, you yeah, against them. I love the
competition. Yeah.
I love the term.
We're going to be at choice. We're going to create right. empowerment through this conversation. It's a much different way to go into it.
See, I like that term at choice. And I think there's sometimes where we lose that perspective. And people may feel that they aren't at choice.
Yeah. I mean, look at our political season right now. It's all about right and wrong and good and bad. And, mm-hmm. and there's very little, room for really listening and really, believing that there could be different views. I have to say, nobody comes from a perfect family. I certainly didn't. But one of the things I most appreciate about my parents was the attitude, and that's how most of us learned our most intuitive ways of communicating was from how our families communicated from a young age.
Well, that becomes our model, whether you know whether it was intentional or not. That becomes right. the model.
That's right. And if they always avoided conflict, then we sort of adopt that. If they always aggressively went after it, then that's what we adopt.
That was the norm.
That's
yeah.
how we see it. But at my dinner table. The dinner table conversation, of course, I grew up in Vietnam War era, and, you know, there's lots to talk about. And so I would come bouncing home from school with some opinion that likely came from a childhood friend's dinner table, right? So, but I would come home and I would start espousing this opinion, And my father would listen and, you know, was a great listener, still is. And he would listen. And then when I was all quite done, he would say, well, that's a really interesting perspective. I really enjoyed listening to that perspective. I wonder, what do you think the other side of that argument, what is their perspective? What do you think their perspective would be? If you were them, if you had to step into their shoes and you had to defend their position, what do you think the defense would be? What is their argument for their side? And so he didn't make me wrong. And he didn't really say I had to choose another way. But what he was saying to me and teaching me was, before you choose, make sure that you actually have explored what that other perspective might be, and then make your choice. So it was a great way to grow up. And so when I create protocols and I help people learn how to come to conflict in a confident way, almost, if this is going to sound really bizarre, I almost look forward to it. But when I do a train the speaker program, and almost every time I teach that workshop, someone will say, well, how do we handle challenges from the audience? When someone raises their hand and they throw us a barb and they throw us a really heated question, or they're challenging our viewpoint on stage, how do we handle that and not lose the room, you know, not lose the audience? And I say to them, you're going to think this is really bizarre. I'm really disappointed when I don't get one of those in the audience anymore. I'm disappointed because I love the exchange. When they throw their hand up and I can see from body language that they're not agreeing, this is somehow challenged some belief they have, and they throw that out there, I literally take a half a step toward them, open up my stance, you know, make sure my arms are open and that I'm embracing the, and I, the first thing I do is I thank them. The first thing I say is, you know what, I'm glad you brought that up, because what it does is it shows me and the rest of all of us in the room that there are lots of different ways of looking at this. And I think it's a very important perspective to consider. Here's what I'd like to suggest. What results are you after? Well, we're after this and this and this. Are you getting them? Well, yes. Then I would say, then keep doing what you're doing. Don't do what I just said. If you're getting everything you want, then do what you're doing. Why would you change? I would just, and then I look at the audience, I just say, if any of you can't answer yes to all of those things, and you're not making all the money you want to make, you're not attracting all the clients you want to attract, you're not having low stress every day in your business life, all of those things, if you're not jumping out of bed every morning, dying to get to work, then there may be something here to consider. That's all, just to consider. And that's, so I don't think there's one right way to do most things. I think there are lots of right ways. Your job is to sift and sort through it all to figure out which one is right for you. So my point is, conflict is hard when there's only one right way. So when I come into conflict, I'm saying, I have an opinion. I have something I want to talk to this underperforming employee about, but I remain open to the two of us creating a whole new way. I remain open. Right now, I have the way that I think is best. And this is, I would say there are some exceptions to this. Gary, you and I both know that in dentistry, if the assistant isn't rinsing the etch off a tooth at the exact number of seconds that etching needs to be rinsed off that tooth, we're not going to get a good outcome clinically.
We'll get a compromised result.
Yes. And so sometimes there are things that there's no other way to do it. There's only one way to do it. And this is, but if you get one step up above that, that's not where I'm talking. When I talk to this employee, I'm saying, I have decided as the manager, as the owner of this practice, this is the way it will be done here. And what I want you to hear from me is, I respect that you might disagree with that and you might not think it's important, and that's okay. And to work here, we would need to shift that. But you don't have to work here, right? You don't have to. And I don't mean that in a threatening way at all. I mean, please don't work somewhere where you can't fully feel confident and morally and ethically strong and in alignment don't do that to yourself, and certainly don't do it to the world, right? Find a place where you align and you feel really confident in the way things are done clinically and otherwise. And so all I'm saying is my job, I think, is to make sure you're really clear that this is the way we're going to do it here, and that I respect and appreciate that you are at choice and you're the one who will decide if that will be something you can embrace and sign on for or whether it isn't. And either way, you'll be fine, I'll be fine, and we'll still be friends. Right?
That's such a powerful way to communicate and again, show that genuineness. That is the truth, that if we're at choice, that person deserves to be, you know, for an underperforming, they deserve to be in a place that they can be true and that can work well for them. It may not be there. And yet they may be, you know, if the communication is done exquisitely, it may be a chance to clarify their opportunity to get on the bus. And that's right. And to be part of this cool thing that you're developing, because maybe they don't understand what that is.
If they say, I do want to work here. It's not that. I just keep forgetting. Mm-hmm. Then I say, great, perfect. Then I'm your partner. I want to be your partner because we can't forget. We can't forget. So what is it I can do to support you in not forgetting? Because if you were to continue to forget, it's still not going to be in alignment. It has to be something. And I have full confidence you have the ability to remember.
Yeah, you have the ability.
So we can either go with an idea you have. We can go with an idea I have. We can, if neither one of us have ideas, we can go find someone. There are resources that we can bring a third party in and get some ideas about how we might do this better. And I have full faith that we'll figure that out. If you want to be here, I have full faith we'll figure it out. It will have to change, and it will have to change by this time or this date. Or, you know, I'm not going in weak. I'm not saying that we're not going to take a stand for how the performance needs to be improved and by when. What I'm saying is, I don't go in to say, look, you know, I'm right and you're wrong, and you're going to have to do it my way, or this just isn't going to work out. In essence, it's that communication, but I do it in a way that is fully respectful and it respects people to take whatever stand they take, and for me to be confident that here it's going to have to be, you know, if someone comes to work for me, there are certain things that we believe in that other coaches and coaching companies don't subscribe to. So if they're going to work here, there has to be this alignment with what we're about. And so, but I don't think that because a company uses scripts that they're necessarily wrong or bad. I really tried to reframe that for myself to say they're going to be perfect for a certain section of the industry population, and for the rest of the population, I probably will have something that will be more in alignment. And so there's room for both of us. There's room for all of us. And it really is about finding mates, employees, clients that are, you know, I can't see every potential business in Southern California. I don't have the capacity to coach them. So I'm only looking for those that are a good alignment for me and what I teach. And I'm only looking for employees that are, you know, a good alignment for what we're up to creating. And that's where, when you say that's all I'm after, then it's really pretty easy to find the words, and they're believable to the people that you talk to. And actually, Gary, I think we changed the world doing this.
I
think there is a trickle down effect that when you treat an employee this way, even in a hard conversation or a child or a spouse, you actually continue to set an example that I think in this political season we see we're so hungry for it. Yeah. We're so hungry for respectful debate and exchange of ideas, and not to be weak, but to be great communicators in our message.
Catherine, I'd suggest that same conversation extends to dentists and their patients, such as our practice may not be appropriate for every patient in the community.
Right.
But for those that value this, and if we could articulate what this is. So if it was life's models, if my prayer for those that value a practice where you're going to be taken care of like a team, like a family member, because our goal is to take care of every patient like we would if as a family member. If you value high quality care delivered by team members who genuinely care about you, if that's the kind of environment you're searching, then we're the right practice for you. That may not be everybody out there. But if it is, we'd love to have you part of our extended dental family. So that conversation applies to our patients as well. Yeah. Katherine, I'm imagining that some of our listeners are very intrigued by this whole direction of unscripted conversation. And we have, you know, dentists, we have team members, we have dental students, we have pre-dental students, office managers listening. If anyone listening wanted to get better and kind of head down the path of improving their skills in unscripted, to become masterful at unscripted communication, how would you suggest they go about doing that, building their skills?
Well, the first thing I'd say is work on your own personal growth, because the words are an extension of where you are, where you have grown yourself. So a lot of times when I give my leadership workshops or lectures, I warn them that the first part of it's going to seem like a personal growth seminar, because it is. Because what is leadership if it's not a reflection of our own, you know, if we can't, we can only lead other people to the degree we could lead ourselves. That's just mm-hmm. the long and the short of it. And so the first thing that we want to work on is, what is that platform we're on? Do we believe that most people, can tap into something greater than they typically tap into? Do we, you know, where are we with that? So in other words, I work on constantly my ability to reframe a situation, to reframe it in a different way, to ask better questions internally. You know, is this the only way this story could go? Is this the only way this person could behave? Is there something I don't know about this person that might shed light on why they behave this way, that might make me a little more empathetic or a little more effective in communicating with them? When you begin to get good at asking yourself those kinds of questions and reframing situations, you're able to control what you do within them so much better. So that's one thing. You know, I'm really good at constantly internally challenging what I believe to be true already. And that has served me really well. So the first step is work on your own personal growth. Always be working on that, mm-hmm. Because then the communication flows from it. The second thing would be to establish a place or space when you communicate with anyone else, a client, an employee, a family member, that your intention is to help both of you, yourself and them, become stronger and better. So I go into any communication saying to myself, I'm going to learn some things here. I'm going to learn some things about myself. I'm going to learn some things I don't want to do again. I'm going to learn some things that work and reinforce that. And I'm hopefully going to help this person do the same. That's a very different platform to speak from.
Oh, it is. Very yep. different. Very different.
The third would be to create some protocols. Create a protocol. Easy. They don't need to be 17 steps. They need to be somewhere between 3 and 5 1 and 5 steps that create the protocol for your new patient phone calls, for any kind of phone call that you do repeatedly. For financial conversations with patients, for treatment presentation, for morning meetings, just create some protocols and then encourage people to come from that space we just talked about where we're constantly challenging what we believe to be true about those situations, but create the protocols. And if you don't know how to do that, hire a coach, hire someone like Gary Takis, hire someone like Katherine Eitel, hire someone to come in and help you create the protocols. Do a workshop where you create something, you go, we can stand behind that. We could feel comfortable delivering that. And then practice. Have someone who knows how to help you practice in a way that you know, is fun and isn't just horrible to get through. That makes it fun, but it this does require practice, and the more you do it, the better it gets. So that would be what I would recommend.
Well, thank you. You've given us some guidelines for those of us that want to improve in those areas. You've given us some great, great suggestions. Katherine, the work that you do is so amazing. I've had the chance to see it firsthand and to see the results and just the amazing transformations, you know, that can happen with your work. I know you're doing something unique coming up here in December. You're doing an office managers leadership camp. And I want to emphasize that's not just for office managers, but that's literally for team members that are in an administrative capacity. And you're doing a leadership camp in San Diego. That's December 8th and 9th. Is that correct?
That's right.
It's
a pilot program. This is the first time we've done it. And we've done it because we've had so many requests from owners, managers, administrators who are in charge of growing their people. And they want to do it in this way. They want to be really good at inspiring. We say communicators have to create two things. You have to create clarity about what it is you're trying to say. And you have to create inspiration for people to want to do it, even if they got clear about it. So this workshop, two-day workshop, is about how do you create clarity for your people so there's no doubt what I'm supposed to be doing, what the standards are, what the protocols are, no doubt. And we also deliver that in a way that it actually inspires people instead of runs them out of the practice. So how do we do both? And that workshop is about that. How do you have employee conversations? And this is a workshop. They're actually going to try on these things. They're going to workshop it. They're going to take current situations they're dealing with, and we're going to put it out on the table and deal with them. And so I'm very excited. It's already, we've had a great response. And I would just say, you know, we have an early bird special until the end of the month. So we'll give some contact information here in a minute, but I'm excited about it. I think there's not much out there like this that's for people. You could be even the owner of a practice, but the point is, are you the one in charge of growing your people? You could be a back office clinical lead. Mm-hmm. If you're in charge of that clinical team achieving excellence, and that's what you're charged with, then this would be a great course for you, because it's just about how do you bring out the best in your people.
That's December 8th and 9th in San Diego. If you haven't been to San Diego, you know, I grew up in San Diego. If you haven't been there, it's not called America's finest city for no reason. It's a fabulous place. December is a fantastic time to be there before the holidays. What a great way to sort of get all charged up to make 2017 their best year yet, right? Great way to prep for the new year. Katherine, I know that our listeners will want to be in touch with you. Would you be kind enough to share your website address?
Of course. They can contact us at Lioness, or find out more information about this and the other things that we offer, at lionesslearning.com. And if they want to email us directly, they can either email my assistant Kelly, which is kelly@lionesslearning.com, or Katherine@lionesslearning.com. Any of those will get you. One will get you directly to my desk, and one to Kelly. If you just need information about dates and registration and things like that, she can certainly help you. But if you want to find out more about the course, if it's going to be a good fit for your situation, and we teach other courses if you're at all wanting to become a trainer or a speaker, we have some workshops for that. And we do vision retreats. We call them calibration retreats for the team.
Oh, I love that title. I love that. I'll put your website address in the show notes. So if you're driving, don't take the hands off the steering wheel. I'll put those in the show notes. You can go to TACAS, TAKACS, learningcenter.com, and find all of Katherine's contact information. I also want to highly recommend that any of our listeners subscribe to Katherine's Monday Morning Stretch. Monday Morning Stretch. Katherine, I return from my run every Monday morning. As soon as I come back into the house, the first thing I do is pull up your Monday Morning Stretch. You have it programmed, so it's in my inbox. It kind of aligns. The universe must be working together for a reason, because it arrives right there. And that's how I start my week, with your Monday Morning Stretch.
Thank you. Well, we have a huge, it's just shocking. It's like your podcast. You know, I think when we put out there what we really are excited about to the world, people get on board, and it's got a huge subscriber base. And I've enjoyed that sort of virtual conversation with so many, just about how do we become better people, better leaders, better communicators. That's really the focus. So I share a lot of what I'm learning out there myself, and it's just been a really fun exchange.
Oh, it's such a great tool, and I'll tell you, I use it very practically. I often will pull up your Monday morning stretch in team meetings, you know, for my team, because there's a lesson within there for all of us. I teach my clients to do that. So, doctors, if you're ever looking for content for your next team meeting, I have a strong feeling that you'll find content in Katherine's Monday Morning Stretch. They're all archived on your website. So go back to lionesslearning.com. Again, I'll put that in the show notes and you can access that. And I have a request for you. If you've gotten anything of value out of our conversation today, reach out to Katherine, send her an email. Just send her a quick email and you can reach her at Katherine@lionesslearning.com and just say thanks. You can just put thanks in the subject line. If you feel like communicating, communicating. Hmm.
Yeah.
There's an idea. If you feel like communicating, jot her a note. I'm sure Katherine, I hope I blow up your server. Not really, but I know you'd appreciate hearing from people. If you have never been to Southern California, you now have a friend in Southern California. Reach out to Katherine, send her a note, tell her thanks. If you've had a chance to attend workshops or hear at a lecture, you know, I'm sure she'd appreciate hearing from you. Just tell her thanks. I know she'd appreciate that.
We all love thinking that we make a difference, you know, so it's nice. It's really nice.
Well, Katherine, I will tell you, you make a massive difference in my life. I often think of the things I've learned from you when I think about when I have to deal with, those critical conversations. I often think about what I've learned and put into place the protocols and things I've learned from you. You're a master. I'll bring it back full circle. I consider yourself a master communication skills coach, and you do your work brilliantly. And I want to thank you for all that you do for our profession. Thanks for the integrity and genuineness that you bring to all of your work, and you're making a difference. And thanks for spending time with us on the Thriving Dentist Show today. It's been great.
But it's like I said when we started, my privilege, and you bring that same level of integrity and passion to this industry, and so it's just a great combo, us two, and I think we align on a lot of these things, and I think that's why it's such a great. Yeah. A great friendship and partnership. It's really great. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. And on that note, I want to say thanks to our listeners. We love what we do here at the Thriving Dentist Show, but we try to always remember we couldn't do what we do if it wasn't for you. So thanks so much. There's three ways you can support our work. Of course, the Thriving Dentist Show is free. It's available on iTunes. It's available on Google Play. Or whatever your podcast directory of choice is. There's three ways you can support us. One is you can tell a colleague about the show. There's many dentists and dental team members, dental professionals that have never heard the word podcast. They don't know what a podcast is. So share with them what this podcasting stuff is all about. Become a podcast evangelist. If you want to talk to them about Thriving Dentist Show, we'd appreciate that. Second thing you can do is you can jump on iTunes and write us a review. We have over 100 five-star reviews. We'd love to get even more. That helps us in the ranking process in iTunes and helps more dentists find us. The third way you can support our work is you can subscribe to the Thriving Dentist Show. It's free, but you can go to iTunes or you can go to Google Play or whatever your podcast directory is. Hit the subscribe button. That means every Wednesday when we upload a new show, it'll be automatically uploaded to your listening device and you'll never miss a future episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. Again, it's free and it's a great way to make sure you keep receiving that content. On that note, let me simply say thank you and tell you I look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.